Nanotechnology, as a general definition, is a creation of functional materials, particularly multifunctional materials, devices and systems through control of matter on the nanoscale. When you come to the nanoscale, things look slightly different. In some cases, very different. This particular length scale in the nano regime, less than 100 nanometers or so, the physical properties almost always undergo a change. So conduction becomes different, mechanical behavior becomes different. When you have material that are in that small scale size regime, very different from the bulk properties. So that makes you very curious, and that also leads to some new kind of applications. I could look at nanotubes from two perspectives. One, as a real extended version of the fullerene, or macromolecular structure, where you've taken a fullerene, cut it into two, and just pull it into a long cylinder. I can also think of it as a nanoscale graphite. Graphite is a material that has existed for a very long time. It's one of the most stable forms of carbon, and there have been lots of applications based on graphite, whether it is carbon fibers or graphite itself, huge applications, all the way from purification, water purification industries, to aerospace, composites. The carbon-based materials have been in use for a very long time. And now, for the first time, you have a material that one could clearly say, here is a perfect graphite. One of the problems with graphite is that graphitization, the process in which the carbon atoms are arranged in this hexagonal honeycomb lattice that makes graphite, is a very high temperature and time intensive phenomenon. So if you want to really make perfect graphite, you have to heat this thing at very high temperature for a very long time. And that consumes a lot of power, and it's also not very. But because these structures are in the nano scale, one was able to create reasonably perfect structures without any defects, pretty much without any defects, without going through this whole process of heat treatment. So I think for the first time, you had a structure one could call, here is a nice structure that is perfect graphite. Normally, if you basically reduce the size of a material, you can assume that it pretty much looks the same up to a certain scale. But here, because this is a sheet-like material, and by folding to make a cylinder, you can make various variations of the same structure. And here you can see a structure of a tube where the hexagons are arranged like this, whereas here the hexagons are arranged in a different orientation. And what is fascinating about this structure is if the diameter of this structure is small enough, then this small variation in how the hexagons are organized completely changes the electronic structure. Right? So for the first time, people realized, here is a structure where you take a simple sheet of graphite, fold it into a cylinder, and by small changes in the way you fold it, you have changed the electronic properties. Right? And I think a lot of attention that was given to carbon nanotubes came out of this particular discovery, that once it is folded into a small cylinder, it's not graphite anymore. It can be very metallic, or it can be semiconducting. So graphite, which is normally not considered as a semiconductor material, normally it's considered as dirt. You don't want carbon to be around when you're making a device. Suddenly became an interesting material for electronics. A survey taken by NSF, a conservative estimate of what these technologies, the market share of these technologies will be by 2010. And you're talking about several tens of billions, and in some cases, hundreds of billions of dollars. And it goes all over the place, all the way from chemical engineering to aerospace and structural materials, to services, to manufacturing, pharmaceuticals. So, nanotechnology is not simply specific to a particular area, but it really spans the whole spectrum of technologies. And that's again the reason why there has been so much investment, so much interest by parties from all kinds of places. What materials, how the materials can impact nanotechnology. They can at least list 10 or 15 different areas which can easily be impacted. Structural materials, and again, in particular relation to carbon nanotubes, I will give some specific examples. But from a materials point of view, I can see that things are going on in structural materials, multifunctional structures, coatings, devices, sensors, actuators, membranes, you name it. I think all of these things have interesting prospects by using nanotechnology and materials in nanotechnology. The real ultimate goal is ultimate control, you know, from the atomic scale. How do you really control every atom or every molecule in a particular structure so that you can very clearly define the final properties of this material that you built or device that you built? But again, the ultimate goal of all this, whether it is a catalyst material, whether it is a device, you want to really understand the role played by every atom. And that is the ultimate goal of this. And you must have, for example, seen the whole range of, a whole spectrum of literature, all the way from Michael Crichton's Prey to the real IBM kind of work, where people talk about all kinds of things. Can you control this to that level that you can create nano machines, which ultimately you will be able to do all kinds of things, as medical devices or whatever it is. Or can you really create control at that scale so that you can really tailor the movement of electrons to make a single electron device? So I think the spectrum is really broad.